The judgment is a state of Jammu and Kashmir versus Sudarshan Chakkar. Sudarshan Chakkar judgment dated 10th of May 1995. And this is the proposition here is that while framing charges in a warrant case upon a police report, the court is required to look into documents referred to in the police report under section 173 CRPC at the time of a framing of a charge and not any other document. So please open the short judgment. We'll go through that. Judgment given by Justice A.S. Anand and Mukherjee's bunch. When you open this, I'll just read it here. That is reported in 1995, 1 SCR, page number 94. I've given it in open credit. The first information report lodged by Director of Food and Supplies, Jammu, a case under Section 120B, 467, 409, and 52 of the Prevention of Corruption Act were registered against the two respondents herein, who at the material time were Tehsil Supply Officers of Ramban, one Najimuddin, a storekeeper, and two transport contractor. The allegation being that they hatch a criminal conspiracy and pursuant to misappropriated food grains and empty bags from the food and supply department worth rupees 3,22,000 so and so, and forging official document. That was a serious allegation. The police vigilance organization took upon the investigation of the case and submitted a charge sheet whereupon a special judge anti-corruption Jammu took cognizance. Thereafter, he heard the parties on the question of framing of charges, please underline this, charges, and held that prima facie case was made out only against other three arraigned, but not the two accused respondents. Accordingly, he discharged them by his order dated 28 June 1993, agreed by the two appellants filed revision application in the High Court, which were dismissed, hence the appeal to the Supreme Court, SLP. On perusal of the record, we find that one of the circumstances on which the prosecution sought to rely and prove the charge against the two respondents was that they did not perform their mandatory duties of monthly inspection of the store supply department, checking the daily remittance of the department. So, I mean, they had not performed, they had discharged their statutory duties under the Act. According to the prosecution, this omission on the part of the respondent for months together along with the other material collected during investigation clearly indicated it was deliberate and the involvement of the DO accused person in the alleged act, particularly offense of conspiracy established in dealing with the circumstances and the case. Observe that at the indicated negligence on the part of the respondent was not the criminal misconduct. The learned court below next referred to and relied upon certain letters purportedly written by the respondent number one to and his higher authorities, wherein he had complained against irregularities being committed by the accused Nizamuddin, to conclude that the letters clearly demonstrated the bona fide of the two respondents. In our consider view, the learned court below erred in bashing their respective orders on two counts. The question whether the respondent omitted to do their mandatory duties or months together designedly and can interfere only in our view that all the material collected during the investigation, not in isolation, has been done by the learned court below. That apart, in a case instituted upon, this is the ratio designedly, that apart, in a case instituted upon a police report, the court is required at the time of framing of the charge to confine its attention to document referred to in section 173 of the code of CRPC. Only in that context, court would not justified in referring to, much less relying upon, letters purportedly written by the accused when their authenticity and veracity were yet to be gone into. So whatever document the police officer collect during investigation submits part of the charge sheet can be relied upon, and not the documents which were not there. At the most, the accused person can produce his in evidence, but not at the time of the framing of a charge. That can be used as a shield, but not as a weapon. In the foregoing discussion, we allow the appeal, set aside the impugn order, direct the trial judge to proceed with the material fresh and accordant with law in the light of the observation made by way of abundant caution. So what the learned magistrate or a court of session should do at the framing of a charge, documents which are relied upon by the prosecution, by the police officer under 173, not other. So others, you cannot be done it here. Similarly, in the civil cases, a little more latitude is given. While framing charges, plain written statement, document, interrogatories can be performed. But in the CRPC, under section 173, do a document, police officer ne laga hai, that only can be done. But in case you have an additional document under the Evidence Act, I will tell you when to use the document. That is at the time, either you cross-examine the witnesses of the prosecution, or that can be used under section 145 for impeaching the credibility of the witness, or under section 157 to prove them they are liar, or to strengthen your own case in your own examination chief. When you are leading your own evidence, I will tell you when the prosecution is required to lead evidence, when the defense is required to lead evidence. Because if the session judge, if the magistrate is satisfied that from the prosecution evidence no case is made out, the magistrate or the court of session will dismiss the case, will say the accused should be discharged, the accused should be the prosecution unable to prove the case, there is no point in going further with the matter. In that event, they don't even call upon the accused person to lead evidence. It is only when the session judge or a magistrate is satisfied the evidence of the prosecution, then they will tell the accused, do you want to lead any evidence? So at that stage, these documents which are supporting the accused, which he has in his possession, and how he got them, he can prove it. Okay, that is the ratio in the judgment. And the last judgment which I have given to you is of the Supreme Court, Kanti Bhandar Shah versus State of West Bengal, dated 5th January 2000, where the ratio is magistrate or a court of session not bound to give detailed reason while framing charges which are considered interlocutory order, unlike a discharge. So, framing of a charge is not a final order. So, heavens are not going to fall. At the most, parties may be allowed to lead evidence, go in the box. But many people, most of the people you are seeing these days, they immediately charges are framed, they go to the High Court, Supreme Court for quashment. Now, what does the Supreme Court says in this regard? When you see the short judgment of the Supreme Court, of the bench of Justice Patnaik and Justice Kehar Singh, Jagdish Kehar Singh judgment, who became the chief. Short judgment is there. It's a little lengthy, but I don't want to read the entire judgment. Relevant portion I'll point out to you. There is an instant controversy out of a double murder committed on the night of so-and-so foundation in the body of the Arushi. That is the Nippur Talwar's case. This is, I'm so sorry. 1 minute. No. I am trying to read Kanti Bhandar Shah's case, sorry. Kanti Bhandar Shah versus State of West Bengal. This is a judgment of Justice Thomas and Justice Mohapatra. The grievance, though the appellant succeeded in the High Court, their grievance still persists. They are not out of the wood. Appellant approached the High Court for quashment of charges. So I told you that no sooner the charges are framed, they go to the High Court for quashing the charges. By the Metropolitan Magistrate, High Court quashed it and directed the magistrate to consider again whether the same charges could be framed again or not. So the matter was remanded back to the magistrate. Now we heard the counsel for the appellant, but we did not find necessary to hear the respondent. So only after hearing the court said that here, on the basis of a complaint with the police station, that is Bura Bazar, Calcutta, an investigation was conducted by the police. On a charge sheet was filed before the Magistrates Court, Calcutta, against appellant for the offences under 454, 380 and 120B of the Indian Penal Code. Theft was committed and trespass was committed. Magistrate issued process, accused had After hearing them, charges were framed of the offences. While framing charges, magistrate, as per the order dated, dismissed the petition of the accused for a discharge. So at the time of the charge, no sooner the charges are framed, the accused person, before framing charges, can make application for discharge, which we read under section 227 under 236 also. So application stood rejected, magistrate framed the charges on a short point of law. Then the investigation officer submitted charge sheet the four accused person under the provision. Then the learned High Court was set aside the aforesaid order, remanded the matter back. It is true the language, then I will only read the relevant portion. Paragraph, you see, 329, when accused shall discharge, then section 240, framing of a charge, that I won't read it. Then it is now after that. It is pertinent to note that section required magistrate to record his reason for discharging the accused, but there is no such requirement if the form's opinion that the ground of charge. So the magistrate is not bound to give opinion for framing charges. He only has to peruse and see prima facie material is there or not. But in the case of a discharge, he has to give reason. But in the case of a framing of a charges, he is not required to give elaborate reason. That is the meaning before. So then see next paragraph. If there is no legal requirement, the trial court should write the order showing so-and-so framing charges. The time has reached and possibly adopt the matter here. Then I won't. Then in the last paragraph, you see that in the present case, Metropolitan Magistrate has chosen to frame charges. The High Court moved the accused person for quashment and could have re-examined the accused, consider the charges frame was sustainable. The High Court decides to quash the charges. It is open for the court to record the reason thereof. The present case, the High Court is of setting aside the charge without stating any reason, but the direction to magistrate to consider a matter once again and frame charges of the offence. If the magistrate reaches opinion, there's a ground for presuming the commission simply to repeat what the Metropolitan Magistrate had done. So to ask him to do again the same thing again, adding unnecessary work on the trial court. Be it maybe as maybe the state has not challenged the order of the High Court, hence, we are not in a position to set aside the impugned order of the High Court. We leave with such matters so and so. So in substance, the what the Supreme Court has said in this matter is that here, it is not, there is no obligation upon the magistrate to give cogent reason. There is no obligation of mine and give a full reason for framing of a charge. But whereas in the question of framing, discharging the accused, which you learned under the provisions of section 225, just open 225, the judge has to give a reasoning. Please see 225 when reasonings are required to be given. 225 discharge. To under 227, if upon consideration of a record of a case and document submitted thereto, hearing of the submission of the accused, prosecution consider that there is no sufficient ground for proceeding, accused shall discharge the accused and record reason for doing so. Underline the word record reasoning. Now, see that framing of a charge 228. It doesn't say, if after such consideration and hearing the accused, the judge of the opinion, there's a ground for presuming that accused committed an offense which is not exclusively triable with the court of session, he may frame a charge against the accused and by order transfer the case for trial to the chief magistrate. So-and-so magistrate and accused person, chief magistrate, as the case may be, judicial magistrate, on such day, as the case may be, shall try the offence in accordance with the procedure or warrant trial case. So there is no obligation to give reasons here. See, the learned magistrate or a session judge is not required to give reason for framing of a charge, but for discharge he has to give reason. Now, similarly, see section 236, provisions of section 239, where reasons are required to be given. When upon considering the police report and document thereon under 173 in making such examination, the accused magistrate think necessary and after giving the prosecution accused opportunity of being heard, he considers necessary charge, groundless he shall discharge the accused and record reason for doing so. So recording of reason is mandatory because discharge is almost a final order. Is a final order, accused will be acquitted. Now see section 240, where reasons need not be recorded. See, if upon consideration, examining, if any, hearing the magistrate of the opinion, there's a ground for presuming that the accused has committed the offense triable under this chapter, the magistrate is competent to try, in which opinion it would be adequately punished by him, he shall frame in writing charges against him accused. So it does not say that you give reasoning for framing a charge. So that is what the Supreme Court said in the judgment of Sahas case, which I read out to you earlier. So because the framing of a charge, as was said by the Supreme Court in V.C. Shukla's case, that is an interlocutory order. So when you see the judgment of V.C. Shukla's case, that is AIR 1980 Supreme Court 962, and the judgment of a DA Desai Chakkarayab, and the relevant page, I'll tell you where is the interlocutory order. Paragraph number, when you see the last paragraph, 108 is winding up. I will see that here. 3-4 line before the last paragraph. Then see, merely because emphasis is laid on the court seriously applying judicial mind, the stage of a framing a charge, and therefore it can be said that an important stage, the order framing a charge even after applying the ratio of the later decision would not be an order other than interlocutory order. It would be unquestionably an interlocutory order. So interlocutory order mean which is not a final order. Now you will find the word expression interlocutory order in the CRPC in also another section, section 397 Chakkarayab. Section 397, CRPC Collegia, that is with regard to revisional powers. The High Court or the Court of Session may examine any record. I won't read the first one. Come to subsection 2. The power of revision conferred under subsection 1 shall not be exercised in relation to any interlocutory order. Underline the word interlocutory order. Nowhere in the CRPC they have defined the word interlocutory order. So interlocutory order, you will have to see the judgment of the Supreme Court in V.C. Shukla's case, and usse pehle the judgment of the Supreme Court and I will give you the other judgment where reliance is placed by the Supreme Court, Vivian Bose judgment in the state of Madhya Pradesh versus CR, that I need not quote you that here, but I will give you another leading judgment, that is Madhulimaya versus State of Maharashtra. In Madhulimaya versus State of Maharashtra, the question arose again whether filing a revision application is an interlocutory order. So, framing if a charge is merely an interlocutory order, no appeal lies against the order. You cannot, it's not a final order. So at the most, you can go in revision. Again, at the revision, subsection 2 says that here, against the order interlocutory, you cannot file revision. So what is the remedy then? Section 482. When revision doesn't apply, where will you come? Under section 482 or article 226, 227 of the Constitution of India. So if one provision doesn't apply, second provision. Okay. Now let us come to the charges now. Now come back to section 211 पढ़े अपने. Yeah. So we are dealing with charges. Yeah. Particulars as to time and place. So a charge must contain. The charge shall contain such particulars as to time and place of the alleged offence and the person against whom it is, in respect of which it was committed, as they are reasonably sufficient to give the accused notice of the matter which is charged. So you must inform the accused how the magistrate frames the charge. I, so-and-so, the judge of the session court, do hereby charge you, accused number one and two, that both of you on so-and-so date, at so-and-so time, committed the murder of Mr. A, Mr. Z, with the common intention, and that was done on account of the rivalry, previous enmity, in respect of a litigation and decree passed in a civil suit where the property was sought to be grabbed by you. And you have deliberately committed the act of murder, wantonly, deliberately, and which is amounting to culpable homicide, amounting to murder. What do you want to say on this? So here, particulars are mentioned. The date is given, the reasoning is given. Now, subsection 2, mein aajaiye. When the accused is charged with a criminal breach of trust, that is section 406 and 409, or dishonest misappropriation of money, section 403 IPC, or with movable property, it shall be sufficient to specify the gross sum or the case may be discernible, movable property in respect of which the offences alleged to have been committed, and the dates between which the offences alleged to have been committed, without specifying particular item or exact date, and the charge so framed shall be deemed to be charge of the offence within the meaning of section 219 of the CRPC. Section 219 speaks of where the offences within the same may be charged together. Subsection 2 says that, subsection 212 mandate that full particulars must be given, time, date and place must be given. But in respect of cases of misappropriation, breach of trust, full particulars need not be given. Maybe because it is not punishable with serious offences, punishable lesser than 7 years' time. But if it is 409, of course, and 406 is 3 years' time, and misappropriation is a lesser punishment. So why they are clubbing it under 209? Because where charges can be clubbed together, normally judges, magistrate and session judges are required to frame separate charges. But an offences which are clubbed together, where there are more than 2, 3, 4 offences committed within the same year or similar nature, the court can, with a view to avoid multiplicity of proceeding, can join it together, joinder of a charge, clubbing of the charge. I'll explain 219. Okay. Then see, provided that the time included in the first last section date shall not be exceed 1 year. So minimum 1 year is the time within 1 year where the offences of cheating, misappropriation, 3, 4 charges are committed, they need not be tried separately. They can be tried by the court by framing the charges, clubbing them together. Now, 213. When matter of committing offences must be stated, when the nature of the offence is such that the particulars mentioned in 211, 212 do not give the accused sufficient notice of the matter with which he is charged, the charge shall also contain such particulars of the manner in which alleged offence was committed as will be sufficient for that purpose. Manner, for example, you committed the murder using a chopper, using a bullet, using your service revolver. That is a manner. You took him, you gave him a poison, you invited him to your house, and in the pretext of giving a party, you had an enmity and you mixed poison. And you committed the matter, that is a manner. So the manner must be, now illustration, karein baat kar lenge. A is accused of theft of certain article at certain time and place. The charge need not set out the manner in which the theft was effected. So subsection 2 of section 212 mein aata, theft, misappropriation and breach of trust, you need not give the full particulars. B, A is accused of cheating B at a given time and a place. The charge must set out the manner in which A was cheated. Here cheating is 420 ke andar, a punishment is 7 years here. The manner of cheating, how he was induced, what kind of misrepresentation he is given. He must have given representation at the time of selling the property look here, I am the owner of the property, which in fact he is not the owner. So believing the representation, look here, my grandfather has made a will. In the will, the property comes to me. So he takes advance money from the defendant. So the gentleman, defendant, or the complainant, who was an innocent man, believing the representation, are yes, iske paas will hai, will ke andar property mil rahi isko, and he is a grandson, why should I not accept it? So he pays money. Then after some time the grandfather dies and he applies for a probate, then he really becomes the owner. When he becomes the owner, the complainant tells him, now you have become the owner, you got the probate, and you please transfer the property. No, at the time when I did the transaction with you, I was not the owner. How can I transfer it to you? So the intentions are dishonest. So when intentions are dishonest here, you have to give the particulars. That is what it says that year. So in a misrepresentation, fraudulent misrepresentation in that year. Now DP Ajayya. CP Ajayya. A is accused of giving false evidence at a given time at a place. False evidence is a perjury under section 193, 194, 195 Indian Penal Code. Now, anybody gives evidence in any civil code, criminal code, even revenue court, is a perjury. Okay. The charge must set out the portion of the evidence which is alleged to be false. So the deposition must be false. So open section 193 of the Indian Penal Code. Punishment for giving false evidence. Whoever intentionally gives, the punishment is here, 3 years time. Then giving fabricated evidence, 194, for procuring conviction. Capital punishment, 10 years. Giving fabricated evidence for procuring conviction, punishable with life imprisonment, 195. Please note that section 193, 194, 195, they are all offenses relating to false evidence giving portion. So in the court of law, when a charge is framed, which portion of the evidence is a perjury? In first paragraph, he said that I am a power of attorney holder. It turned out that your power of attorney is bogus. That means he has no authority to give evidence. So the judge must say that you produce a bogus power of attorney. You are not an authorized person. So that is the meaning here when you say that here, you must give the charge, must set out that the evidence which is charged. So the deposition given by him, giving a false representation about his ownership right, is false. And the statement has been made by him before the court of law, before the judge in the high court, that he filed a suit for declaration of ownership of right, producing bogus certificate, bogus title deeds. So what are you committing? Offenses affecting the administration of justice. So when such evidence is brought on record, when perjury action is taken, and tomorrow and next time I'll deal with you, how a perjury complaint is filed. It is not filed separately in a criminal court. It is filed, suppose you are giving evidence in high court, city civil court, in a civil matter, and it is found out that it is a perjury, is a fabrication. The learned judge who tried your matter, maybe the high court judge, city civil court judge, small cost court judge, collector, he can take action against you. They can refer the case to the judicial magistrate, first class, second class, by presenting an application under section 340 CRPC, that is known as offenses affecting the administration of justice, that will leave it. The court itself become the complainant against you. Okay. Now come to illustration number. D. A is accused of obstructing B, a public servant, in the discharge of his public function at a given time and place. The charge must set out the manner in which obstructing B in discharge of his function. So the police officer, for example, under the provisions of section 190, aapne seekha aapne, isn't it? Offences against it, offences against relation to public servant duty. Yeah. Where are you obstructing public servant here? Offences against... What are the relevant sections, you know that? How get the offences? 196 onwards, no, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, 172 onwards. Under 172, you are not cooperating with the police officer. And you are not giving information, omission 176. You are furnishing false information under 177 about your whereabouts. You are not producing documents which have been asked to produce under section 175. You have been told to, over being legally bound to produce, deliver documents, electronic record to any public servant intentionally. So when you have been told to produce electronic record, then you are bound to duty bound to bid. Then you have been told to produce public servant, any bound to give evidence under 176. If that is the situation, the charge must be specific. Now, under the pandemic, under the in the present law, you are being told to wear your mask, isn't it? By a police officer catches you, then he can prosecute you under the pandemic laws. You know that even under the IPC, and you try to run away when the police officer is taking. So that you are committing an offence against the public officer, that is a contempt of lawful authority of a public servant. So when a charge is framed, the charge must disclose here what is the offence you are committed, is the obstruction. Then A is accused of murder of B at a given time and place. The charge need not state the manner in which A was murdered. So manner of committing murder need not be given. Evidence is on record, the dead body is there. The postmortem report is there. The scientific evidence report is there. So main manner of required, please, you must remember this illustration. They may come to an examination point of view. Anybody want to ask me any question on this? Please ask. Before we go to 214. Puchna hai kisi ko? 214 mein aa jaiye. Words in charge taken in sense of law under which offense is punishable. In every charge, word used in describing the offense shall be deemed to have been used and attached to them respectively by the law under which the offense is punishable. So in the charge itself, the court is a responsibility of the judge to frame the charges. The charges include the sections. So those sections need not be provided by the accused person. Then see, effect of an error, where effort. No error in stating either.
Sir, can you explain section 214 once again?
Words in charge taken in the sense of law under which offense is punishable. In every charge, words used in describing the offense shall be deemed to have been used in the sense attached to them, respectively, by the law under which such offense is punishable. So the section 214 mentioned some of the offenses mentioned the word here, culpable homicide, isn't it? So culpable homicide is a term which has been used. Culpable homicide or the murder caused with the undue provocation. Undue provocation is a term which is used under the provisions of the CRPC. So under section 204, the magistrate or a judge need not again record it. The charge itself will include it along with the section in the matter here. So there is no error in that regard, but the accused person can always explain to the judge, please elaborate this and make me understand this. I have not understood what is the charge under which I am being charged to, and describing the offense deemed to have been done. It is along with the section is attached. Section 300A, Section 87 of the CRPC, where offenses are punishable. A ground is taken of insanity. Our insanity is attached to it here. That is the meaning of a section. Effect of error. No error. See, illustration check. No error in stating either the offense or the particulars required to be stated in charge, and no omission to state the offense punishment shall be regarded at any stage of a case as a material unless accused was misled. So normally at the time charges are framed, a prosecution normally should not take mistake. Only in case the accused is affected, he can raise question. In case there is a doubt or omission, he can lead evidence, he can rebut it. Like framing of a charges, if charges are not framed, evidence is laid, sufficient material, non-framing of the issues and non-framing of a charge, it does not vitiate the entire trial. If erroneously they have been framed, if some omission taken place, it is no illegality. Now see the illustration. A is charged under section 242 of the Indian Penal Code. Please open section 242. Keep your section 242 open. Possession of counterfeit coin by person knowing it to be counterfeit when he became possession thereof. It's a very serious charge. It is a punishable for a term which may extend to 3 years. Now, counterfeit coin, jolly note rakha kisi ne uske andar. A charge under 242, which having been in possession of counterfeit coin, having knowledge at the time when it became possessed thereof, such coin was counterfeit, the word fraudulently being omitted in the charge, unless it appears A was in fact misled by the omission, the error shall not be regarded as material. So if by virtue of the mistake or omission, if they have dropped a particular word that is fraudulently as used in section 242, section 242 is using the word fraudulently, but while framing of a charge, the word fraudulently is omitted. So mere omission is not fatal. It depends whether evidence is there or not. Agar evidence ke andar miss kar diya gaya, there is no cross-examination, then you may take up the plea that here the expression fraudulently having not been used, I cannot be convicted. You can argue on that point. But merely because fraudulently is not used in the charge, but subsequently evidence is led to show that you had done this act fraudulently, you can be convicted. And that is the meaning here. B. A is charged with cheating B, and the manner in which cheating B is not set out in the charge, A is set out incorrectly. A defends himself, calls the witnesses and gives his own count of the transaction. The court may infer from this that the omission to set out the manner of cheating is not material. So under the provisions of the 213, illustration B, A is accused of cheating B given time. The charge must set out the manner in which cheating B. So it must be given. In case there is an omission to mention this, it is not fatal. Provided there is a material to convict him. Samjhana aap hai? If there is a material to convict him, the mere omission is not omitted. So similarly, in the case of civil proceeding, a particular issue is not framed, but evidence is led. I will show you the consequences, but without the issue being there, if there is evidence and record, court can pass a decree. Next. See, A is charged with cheating B, and the manner in which cheating B is set out in the charge, there may be transaction A, B, and A had no means of knowing to which of them he is charged, referred to the offer to defend. The court may infer from the fact that omission set out in the manner was in fact a matter of error, what was a material error. Here, in such a manner, in the case of C, prejudice is likely to be caused to the accused person because transactions are A, B, and A had no means of knowing which of the charges referred to offer to defend. So, without specific charge being framed, you are trying to proceed against him. That will be unfair. In that such a scenario, you cannot do that. D, A is charged with the murder of Khoda Baksh on 21st June 82. In fact, the murder, in the murdered person name was Haider Baksh. And the date of the murder was 20th January 82. A was never charged with any murder of one and had heard the inquiry before the magistrate, which referred exclusively to the case of Haider Baksh. The court may infer that these facts, A was not misled and the error in the charge was immaterial. So, in the earlier case, the charge was, the error was material one. Here, there is a name, there is a misunderstanding, miscalculation, there is an error in the pronouncing the name of a person. But only one person was dead, that was maybe Haider Baksh or it is some other Baksh. When inquiry is held, his name was there. But if his name is not correctly mentioned, Khoda Baksh, then it doesn't mean that here the any great immaterial is a great injustice is called. The error which is happened, it is not an error apparent on the face of the record. It is not very much material. That means the trial can proceed and it is not prejudicial to the accused person. And he may take up the plea, various plea like alibi, I was not available, he was not there, but he had not committed the murder prosecution. But at the time, when a charge is framed, the nomenclature, the mistake in the name is not very grave mistake. E. A is charged with murdering Haider Baksh on 20th March 82 and Khoda Baksh, who tried to arrest him for murder on 21st so-and-so. When charged for the murder of Haider Baksh, he was tried for the murder of Khoda Baksh. The witnesses present in the defense were witnesses in the case of other. The court may infer from A was misled and the error was material. Here definitely there's a serious and irregularity in the matter. Haider Baksh is a different man and Khoda Baksh is a different man. The murder of Haider Baksh and Khoda Baksh was tried. You cannot do that. It's a wrong identity. The person who is sought to be prosecuted is a different man. In such a scenario, you have not conducted identification parade. Without conducting identification parade, you cannot make any Tom, Dick and Harry as the accused. So, the accused may take up the plea of alibi. I was in Calcutta at the time of the offense in Bombay of Haider Baksh. I was not there. So, the charges will be. So, this is the meaning of here. When there is a material irregularity, when he can be misled, when prejudice is caused. Is it understood here so far? Samajh mein aaya? Then we'll take up. Now, alteration of a charge, when the court can make alteration, the amendment of charges, like in the civil procedure court, when the court can also alter the issues, change the issues, frame the recharge issue. Let us see. Any court may alter or add any charge at any time before judgment is pronounced. Interesting, see that here. When you see a counter section in the CPC, in the CPC order 14, check karo, aisa hi charge batata hu, power of the court, order 14, rule 15, mere khayal se. Just showing it to you. Yeah, order 14. Question me. Order 14, Rule 5, power to amend strikeout issues. See that here, the court may at any time before a decree amend additional charges and so and so charges here, so and so. So, similarly, in the same background, the criminal court under section 216 can may alter charges. Any court, matlab here the High Court, Sessions Court, Magistrate. Alter an act to any charge any time before judgment is pronounced. It should be done because an opportunity must be given to the accused before pronouncing judgment, whether you want to lead any evidence, whether you want to recall any witnesses, because under 311 we have seen the court has power to recall any witnesses. Now see, item number 2, every such alteration or addition shall be read and explained to the accused. So, whatever new charges which are sought to be brought, suppose a charge is earlier filed of conspiracy, the second charge which are altering it into something of a criminal breach of trust. So, there are differences here. Then, if the alteration or addition of a charge is such, the proceeding immediately with the trial is not likely, in the opinion of the court, the prejudice to the accused in the defense or prosecutor in the conduct of the case. The court may, in the discretion after such alteration addition has been made, proceed with the trial as if he altered or added such a charge has been original charges. So the full discretion is given to the court. Both the prosecution and accused person can suggest, my lord, some charges have been omitted, they are required to be framed. Some charges have been framed wrongly, they need to be dropped. That can be brought. Item number 4. If the addition or alteration is such that the proceeding immediately with the trial is likely in the opinion of the court, the prejudice to the accused or prosecutor, the court may either direct the new trial or adjourn the trial for such period as may. So, in the event by virtue of the new addition and alteration, the new trial is required, earlier charges are to be wiped out, a de novo trial can take place. Suppose matter went to the High Court, Supreme Court level. Supreme Court, High Court found that here, the earlier charges which are framed, there is no evidence as such. In fact, the charge should have been culpable homicide amounting to murder it should be 304A, that is the death is caused on account of negligence, which is not framed. Or maybe one of the exception under section 300, it was the murder was caused out of grave provocation. The charge is not framed. So the entire charge matter will be remanded back to the trial court, sessions court, for retrying the matter and setting aside by virtue of subsection 4. 5. If the offense stated to be in the altered added charges is one of these prosecution which previous sanction is necessary, the case shall not be proceeded with until such sanction obtained, unless sanction has been already obtained, prosecution on the same fact or on those which the already added so and so. Now, this deal with some of the offenses, you know that here, complaint filed by the complainant without the sanction of the competent authority, no trial can take. Section 197 CRPC padhe humne, isn't it? Where you require the sanction. For example, Kerala Assembly Ruckers case, isn't it? The Supreme Court said that here, permission was granted by the speaker. So, unless the speaker grants permission, trial cannot take place. A public servant or a judge or a public servant or a magistrate, you want to prosecute on corruption charges, the Loka Ayukta must give sanction. Though the police can arrest the person, produce it and remand, bail ho sakta hai. But framing of a charge can only be done provided you have taken the permission of the Lokayukta under section 197.1 CRPC. In the case of a in the case of a police officer who is removable from service, You have to take the permission from the state government, CID, central government, public servant, who are removable. So the various provisions are given here. Cognizance cannot be taken unless and until. And you cannot prosecute a member of a parliament without the speaker's permission being taken. Isn't it? We have learned many, many cases. So the charges here under the provisions of section 216 subclass speaks here, without the sanction. Now, in many cases into the Indian Penal Code for outraging, for creating religious offenses, creating hatred, you require permission and sanction under section 500 padhe na apne. For example, I'll just point out to you. Please see. Sanction is required in many offenses. I will 197 ka check kare aapne. Then what are the offenses where permission is required? IPC zara khol lijiye. When you see offenses against the state, against offenses against religion, where you are required to take permission of the government. Without the government permission, you cannot do that here, isn't it? 295A wala dekhe aapne, outraging the 295A, deliberate malicious intent to outrage religious feeling of person. That is section 295A kholiye aap IPC ka. Now, during the election time, these days it is very, these are famous charges, isn't it? 295A, dekhiye. Yeah, deliberate, malicious, intending to outrage religious feeling, any class, so and so. Here you require sanction of the magistrate, of the government, uttering words. Even section 500 and may, certain one section is there, where you require permission. The criminal intimidation checker of section 505, na, isn't it? Punishment for criminal intimidation. Where is the sanction required? Word, gesture, insult, modesty of a woman. Accused person believing their will to be rendered object of punishment for criminal intimidation, 506, 507, intimation by anonymous written. So there are certain offenses where you require the sanction. So without the sanction, I mentioned to you under section 197, you cannot file a case against a public servant, judges, without the sanction. Similarly, a public prosecutor cannot file a defamation case under 199. You learned, no? A public prosecutor can, for defamation of the President of India, Vice President of India, under 199.2, he has to file a complaint directly in the court of session, for which he requires sanction. See, subsection 4, no complaint under subsection 2 shall be made by the public prosecutor, except with the previous sanction. So the sanction is required under 197. So that is what the provisions of section 200 and come back to the charges. Understood now this one? Samajh mein aaya? Understood this?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So yahan pe charges le permission le lenge aapne. Charge unnecessary shall not be proceeded with the 217 mein aa jaiye. This may be the last section before we time permits. We'll see. Recall of witnesses when charge altered. When witnesses can be recalled. See, whenever a charge is altered or added by the court after commencement of the trial, the prosecutor shall be allowed to recall, resummon, examine with reference to such alteration, addition, witnesses who may have been examined, unless the court for reason to be recorded and then consider the prosecution or accused, the case may desire to recall examination witness for the purpose of a vexatious delaying the proceeding, uncalled further evidence in the matter. Now, when a charge is, new charge is brought, charge is altered, it becomes necessary for both the parties sometime to re-examine witnesses, to lead further evidence. Because unless you rebut the case, you are likely to be prosecuted, you are likely to be convicted. So that provision you will find under the provisions of section 311 Collegia. 311 Collegia. Power to summon material witnesses or examine person present. Any court may at any stage of inquiry, trial, other proceeding under this court summon any person, witness, examine any person in attending to examine so and so. Recall, re-examine. Okay? Provision to recall, re-examine any person already examined in the court, such summons and re-examine, recall, examine in evidence appears to be essential for the justice. Now, this is the power of the trial court. Now, even the appellate court has power to recall witnesses. When you see section 300, and I will give you one, the provision here, 391, mere khayal se, section 391, check karo aap. Section 391, check karo, even the appellate court. Appellate court may take further evidence direct to be taken. It is not only the trial court who has got power. See that here. In dealing with any appeal under this chapter, the appellate court, if it thinks additional evidence to be necessary, shall record reasons may be taken, evidence directed to be taken by the magistrate, or when the appellate court, high court, as the session court magistrate, or where the additional evidence is taken by the session, the magistrate, he shall certify so and so. So then the accused shall be him. So there are wide powers are given to the trial court under section 311 and to the appellate court under 391 when charges have been altered, new charges have been added. Now such a provision you will find for leading additional evidence in CPC also. So I pointed out to you order 14 rule 5 where the court can alter frame the charges. Now see for leading evidence, order 18 rule 17 check karo. Civil code ke andar order similar I am pointing out, order 18 rule 17 check kare. Court may recall re-examine witnesses, CPC, yeah? Because you learned, I showed it to you right now, under order 14 rule 5, court may amend the charges at any time before the decree, before judgment is passed. It's a similar provision like the under the provisions of CRPC. Now, in the civil cases, when the civil judge has altered the issues or frame new issues, what is the next course will be? Court may recall and examine witnesses under order 18 rule 17. See that? The court may at any stage of a suit recall any witness who has been examined and may any stage of law evident for the time being put such question to him at the cause meeting. So there are very wide power. Similarly, the appellate court under the CPC has power to lead evidence and examine witness. Please open order 41, rule 27A. Order 41, rule 27A mein aa jaiye. See, order 21, rule 25 mein court can frame the issues. Now, 27 mein aa jaiye aap, protection of additional evidence at appellate stage. This is like powers in the CRPC under section 391. Isn't it? Production of additional evidence by appellate court. The parties to an appeal shall not be entitled to produce additional evidence, whether oral or documentary, in the appellate court. But if the court from whose decree appeal is preferred has refused to admit evidence which ought to have been admitted. Number two, parties seeking production of additional evidence establishes all notwithstanding the exercise of due diligence. Such evidence was not within his knowledge, could not, after exercise due diligence, be produced with him when given so-and-so. The appellate court requires any document to be produced or witnesses enabled to produce or so-and-so. The appellate court may allow the evidence on document produced. See, the appellate court also can reframe issues under Order 41, Rule 25. The appellate court may frame issues and refer the try to the trial court. This is called remand stage here. So, when you compare the provisions of CPC and CRPC, the power of the CRPC appellate court are much more wider than the magistrate court, or more or less both are procedural laws. In my opinion, what the Supreme Court has said, both CPC and CRPC are procedural laws. Procedural laws must be construed in a liberal manner for advancing the cause of justice, and they should not be construed and they should not be interpreted rigidly so that the parties are disappointed or there is a miscarriage of justice or it impedes justice. The approach of the court must be to facilitate justice and not to impede justice. So the provisions of both CPC and CRPC in the matter of recording evidence, in the matter of framing issues, in the matter of framing charges, they must be quite liberal. And they must see to it that there is no injustice to any party. The criminals, the CRPC should not see that here the accused person is prejudiced, nor the prosecution is prejudiced. The court must be transparent. The court must give full opportunity to both the parties, both in civil and criminal cases. Ultimately, you have a chance to establish your case, lead your own evidence. Why should you not? Because issues are framed from the material and record in the pleading. Charges are framed from the charge sheet, from the document produced by the prosecution. Remember that. That is the difference here. The civil judge can only frame charges from the pleading of the parties, from the interrogatories, from the affidavit, from the pleading, plain and written statement. Whereas the criminal judge, session judge, will frame charges only from the police report under 173 and the document produced by the prosecution. And the civil and the public and the magistrate or session judge is not bound to give elaborate reasoning at the time of framing of the charges because the order is interlocutory. Similarly, a civil judge, while framing issues under the provisions of Order 14, need not give elaborate reasons. And he may tell the parties, you exchange the draft issues and give it, I will settle the issues. He will give opportunity. He may record evidence of the parties. If there is no evidence need to be recorded, both the parties may agree. As civil judge, I will also take tomorrow, when the day after tomorrow, he can ask questions can be, issue can be framed on a preliminary point of law, such as the suit is barred by particular statute. The suit is a res judicata. The suit is withdrawn earlier. Second suit cannot be filed. Previous notice under Section 80 of the CPC has not been governed. So the suit should be tried by the court of law. So these are procedures and provision. I think according to me, this should be fine for the day today. And next lecture, we'll take up the remaining lecture. Anybody want to ask me any question, please ask. Bear in mind the provisions of Section 391, 311 in the CRPC for additional evidence of the appellate court and trial court. And in the CPC, Order 18, Rule 17, and under the provisions of Order 41, Rule 27A, where the appellate court has power to records additional evidence. So, from this today's lecture, anybody wants to ask me any question, please go ahead. Time kitna ho gaya abhi? Ho gaya na? Kumar?
Yes, sir. We have completed work.
We are finished. Anybody question? Leave question hours.
Anybody has any question, please let me know. 5 minutes will be given for question session. You can ask me question both in CPC and CRPC from the topic which we have done so far in framing of the issues or any other topic I am prepared to answer. Okay? Even the topic which I have not taught you in CPC and other professors reaching you, you can ask me questions and I will answer them gladly. Yeah? Therefore, tomorrow I will complete the entire chapter on the framing of the charges. Then I will also take you how the session judge, the magistrate frame charges and in a session trial and a warrant trial by the magistrate. Then how the evidence takes place, how the role of Evidence Act come into play. What are the types of evidence that I will discuss tomorrow, that is there for tomorrow. If nobody has any question, you will have question provided you read and come. I am circulating the material, please go through. Advance mein padh ke aayenge to question puchenge aap, nahi padhenge to nahi kar payenge. I will appreciate if you read. I will circulate some of the judgment tomorrow, but day after tomorrow, please read and come. Because they may be, I will mention the, because I am not reading the entire judgment for you and waste your time. Only the ratio desiderandi. The material portion of the judgment which supports your case, like today, VC Sipla judgment is more than 200 pages. I don't want to read it. The material portion where the Supreme Court explained what is a framing of a charge. What is the importance of a charge? What is the meaning of charges and accusation, which the accused person is supposed to know, isn't it? Which has not been defined. Charge is simply a means of accusation for the purpose of a trial, isn't it? It signifies a formal accusation in writing against a person. However, the code of CRPC doesn't define properly. 2B is very unsatisfactory. And I have checked the General Clauses Act is not defining. Then you have to go by dictionary meaning or what the Supreme Court has decided. So the Supreme Court has been pleased to define a charge in the V.C. Shukla's case, particularly the judgment of Justice D.A. Desai. Please note that an examination mein likho aap. Note down the paragraph, particular, just 4 or 5 lines ka hai, is not very well. Then I took up the plea that 2 judgments I quoted to you, the charges of frame from the police report, that is a judgment of a state of Jammu and Kashmir versus Sudarshan Chakkar's case, 1995, 4 Supreme Court cases. Then I also brought to your notice a judgment of the Supreme Court. The judge, the magistrate or the session judge need not give elaborate recording of reason for framing of a charge as held by Supreme Court in Kanti Bandar Shah versus State of West Bengal, that is 2001 SCC, page number 722. Only the magistrate or a session judge has to record reason, give cogent reason, only for discharge under 225 and 236. But not framing of a charge, they are regarded as interlocutory orders. So even when a magistrate is issuing order under section 156(3) CRPC, he doesn't have to record much reason. He is not taking cognizance. It is a precognizance stage. He's telling the offenses are serious nature, according to me, police investigation. But if he is taking cognizance under 200, the magistrate has to give reason. He has to apply his mind. He has to examine witnesses. He has to examine the complainant and give cogent reason for taking cognizance. If he doesn't give cogent reason, the High Court will quash it under 482. Please note that. This you should know when the reasons are required to be given, when reasons are not required to be given. For framing of a charge, cogent reason is not required to be given. Okay? Is that okay? Anybody has any last?
Yes, sir.
Final call for questions, which I would be delighted to answer. If there is no question, we can wind it up. So waiting from your end. The ball is in your court. Okay, it appears all of you understood the lecture and no question. And please read tomorrow and come from the remaining section. I will take 221 से लेता हूँ मैं. Isn't it? Sorry. Today we have taken 217. 218 से लूँगा. I will complete the entire portion on charges next time. Section 218 से पढ़ के आइए आप. Section 218 to section 224. ज़्यादा नहीं. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sections only. You read them and come. Then you also have a glance at a trial before a court of session, especially framing of charges. That is section 228, framing of charges, and a trial before a warrant cases, framing of charges is section 240. वो देख लीजिए. Then, under the provisions of summons cases, under the provisions of summon cases, section 251 says formal charge need not be framed. Last paragraph, सुनिए यहाँ पे. There is no formal charges in summons cases or in summary cases, because summary cases have to be tried like summons cases. So there is no charges are framed there. Shall be followed. See, section 262 says. Summary trial, in a trial under chapter, this chapter, that is a chapter 21, the procedure specified in the court trial for summon cases shall be followed, That means there is no necessity to frame a specific charge. Magistrate is only under obligation to frame a charge in cases where the case is triable by warrant cases by magistrate instituted on a police report by virtue of section 240 CRPC. And the session judge, by virtue of his provisions of section 228 CRPC. Itna padh ke aaiye. Shall we wind up for the day?
We can, sir.
You do not want me to go up? We can, no?
We can continue.
Why to continue?
We can continue. Today's topics are quite easy, sir.
नहीं आज के लिए बस हो गया. मैं
अभी आया. In comparison with other days.
No, I got other meeting. I called some clients to attend to meeting. I think this is what you told me, 45 minutes. We have exceeded. We stop it now here. Some of the time when we are discussing judgment, we can take longer time. Okay? Nothing, everything sure, is sir. Cool now. Sure, take sir. It easy. And okay. Now we'll meet. Now our next lecture will be on Monday. Okay? I will circulate sure, the sir. Judgments to be. I told you, apart from the one lecture, I will concentrate on... the remaining charges, and one lecture will be on medical complaints, how the complaint against doctors yes. are lodged. It is not an easy procedure. It's a very yes, difficult sir. Procedure. That I will explain to you. And under the provisions of the law of tort also, the doctrines I have shared with you, how it is to be lodged. वो भी देख लेंगे. एंड कंज्यूमर कंप्लेंट के अंदर डॉक्टर्स के खिलाफ कंप्लेन होता है, अंडर द लॉ ऑफ टॉर्ट भी होता है, अंडर द आईपीसी होता है. I will summarize all the three procedures, when you can convict a doctor under the CRPC, and when you can claim damages in the Consumer Protection Act for deficiency of service on the part of a negligent doctor, and when you can claim damages under the law of tort, gross negligence on the part of a doctor, when the doctrine of res ipsa liquidator applies or not applies, in what cases it applies or not. There's
Jacob Martin's case and the judgment of just. Dr. Gupta's case, I circulated before, and I have to recapitulate. I will once again send it. Okay, chalo, all of you have a nice weekend and good night. Okay?
Good night, sir.
Okay, good night. Bye-bye.